The next step in making planets focuses just on the solid material that condenses out of the disk. Solids condense out as tiny dust grains and snowflakes. However, they can quickly grow through collisions. Turbulence in the gas can help with this by concentrating dust grains in small areas where they can clump together more quickly. We call this buildup through collisions solid body accretion. Something like this happens in most people's houses, under their beds and behind the refrigerator. That's where dust grains and other random bits accrete together to form dust bunnies. Then the dust bunnies accrete to form dust buffalo, and then they can start roaming out across the room in vast herds until you finally get around to vacuuming. Similarly, the dust grains and ice particles in the disk clump together to form ever larger bodies. When they get bigger than a kilometer across, we start calling them planetesimal. When they're this size, their own gravity starts becoming important enough that it begins to affect the paths of smaller objects around them, focusing more debris to help them grow faster. When enough planetesimals accrete that they form a body 1,000 kilometers across, we call that a protoplanet. By this point, its gravity is large enough that it stirs up the surrounding planetesimals into relatively high eccentricity orbits, so that when they collide with each other, they're moving very fast. This causes them to shatter rather than accreting to form competing protoplanets. This painting shows what a collision between two protoplanets might have looked like.
At the start of the accretion process, gravity between solid particles is too weak to play a role in pulling them together. Instead, electric charges are the key to holding things together. That's why we referred to dust bunnies in the last slide. The same sort of electrostatic forces that make dust grains, or even socks from the dryer, stick together are also responsible for holding dust grains together in the disk. Eventually, the growing planetesimals become large enough that gravity does become strong enough to help hold them together. At first, it acts to simply keep loose agglomerations of material from drifting apart. This produces the sort of rubble pile bodies we see in the asteroid belt. Later stages of accretion can produce the heat and pressure needed to fuse this material into larger solid masses. Electrostatic forces don't work on gases. That's simply because the gas molecules are moving much faster, so these forces aren't strong enough to pull gas in. In fact, gas won't be pulled into growing protoplanets in significant amounts until they're much larger than the Earth. We'll see that shortly.
The solid body accretion step lets us understand another one of the observations about the solar system that we discussed at the start of this chapter, the composition of the planets. As we saw then, planet compositions don't match the composition of most things in the universe. There's too much heavy material compared to hydrogen and helium. However, if planets form from the accretion of solids, then this makes sense. Pure hydrogen and helium don't form solids, so they don't count. Instead, just those rarer rocks, metals, and hydrogen compounds go into building planets at this stage. So these are the materials that we see in the planets. You should be asking now, what about the giant planets? How do they get their hydrogen and helium if they form from solid body accretion? In fact, they're going to need another step called gas accretion. We'll have a look at that shortly. But first, we've got to look at one other result of solid body accretion. As we described earlier, the late stages of planet formation involve collisions between large protoplanets. Often, the last few collisions in these simulations are big ones. Collisions between planet-sized bodies. There can be only a few collisions like this, and each one will be a unique event. Sometimes they'll be dead center. Other times, they'll be glancing blows. Sometimes the two bodies will be virtually the same size, while other times one will be much larger than the other. Whatever the collision is like, the planet that results from it will be dramatically changed in some way that will make it distinct from the other worlds around it. If each giant collision is a unique event, then the scars of these collisions will be some of the characteristics that make individual planets and moons unique. In other words, the exceptions that we described in our list of trends in the solar system. So a giant impact can knock a planet spin over, giving an extreme tilt like the one Uranus has. Later in this lecture, we'll see some even more dramatic effects from giant collisions. So exceptional collisions like this can produce the exceptional objects in our solar system. Solid body accretion operates throughout the forming solar system. However, when a planet gets large enough, a new form of accretion becomes more important, gas accretion. Remember that gas hasn't been involved in the accretion process up to this point, because gas molecules move too fast to be held in either by electrostatic forces or by the gravity of smaller protoplanets. However, as these protoplanets made of rock, metal, and ices got much larger than the mass of the Earth, their gravitational pull got large enough that they could begin holding on to the gas that made up roughly 98% of the disk. At first, a growing protoplanet only captures a little bit of this gas. But once it reaches a mass of about 10 Earth masses, it's able to pull in more gas than rock and ice. From this point on, gases dominate its accretion, and it can grow to many times its original size. Remember that the more gas it accretes, the more mass it has, and hence the stronger its gravitational pull. So gas accretion starts to run away. We'll see more examples of these sorts of runaway processes when we talk about positive feedback systems in atmospheres near the end of the semester.
It's worth mentioning at this point that both solid body and gas accretion heat up a planet. We'll look at this more in the next chapter, but in the meantime, it's worth pointing out that while a protoplanet may start out forming from ice, rock, and metal, as it grows, first the ice and later the rock and metal will certainly melt from all those collisions. When the gas is captured, it heats up the protoplanet even more, so that when a large protoplanet forms, its interior can easily get well over 10,000 kelvins, much hotter than the surface of the sun.
This rapid gas accretion will continue until the planet has cleared out most of the gas at its distance from the star. This leaves a gap in the disk around the star, a ring with very little gas in it. The gas being accreted by the planet doesn't necessarily fall straight onto it. Just like the gas that collapsed to form the star, this gas will generally have some spin to it, so some of it will form a disk around the growing planet. Think about what this means. You've got a planet forming in the disk around the star. At the same time, a smaller subdisk of gas and dust forms around the planet. All of the processes we described earlier of condensation and solid body accretion in the formation of planets will be repeated in these subdisks. So there's every reason to believe that solid bodies will start to form around the planet just like planets form around the star. Gas accretion appears to be responsible for most of the mass of Jupiter and Saturn. Their cores are around 10 Earth masses, with 85 to 300 Earth masses of accreted hydrogen and helium gas. Uranus and Neptune are a little more complicated. They also have cores around the same size, but they only have a few Earth masses of hydrogen and helium. While they clearly had some gas accretion, it may have happened late enough that there wasn't much gas left to accrete in the outer solar system. The smaller solid bodies that formed in the subdisks became moons. It's likely that most of the large and medium-sized moons that we see around the giant planets formed this way. Some of the small moons may have also formed this way, but many of these also appear to be captured bodies, since they orbit their planets backwards. In the case of Jupiter's moons, we even see signs that the planet was hot enough to produce a frost line while the moons were forming. The inner moons, like Io and Europa, are mostly rock and metal, while the moons further out have up to half of their mass in the form of water ice. It's likely that the Jovian planets formed before the terrestrial planets. There are a couple of reasons to expect this. First, the larger masses in the outer solar system meant that solid body accretion happens faster there. Once these planets get up to a 10 Earth mass size, gas accretion happens over a small number of orbits. The other reason is observational. When we observe disks around other stars, we find that the gas and dust disks get much thinner or disappear within 1 to 10 million years. This is probably too fast for a terrestrial planet to finish forming out of rock and metal, but it's enough time for an outer solar system protoplanet to form and go through gas accretion. Here's another hypothetical solar system. In this case, I'd like you to look at the planets described and then write down whether or not these planets seem surprising in light of our picture of how solar systems form. In other words, don't just ask if these are different from our own solar system or not. Instead, think about whether it seems likely that planets like this could form the way we've described it. If they can, then explain how. If they can't, then explain why not.
We've just described the formation of Jovian planets and their moons. But you might be thinking, what about the terrestrials? To understand what's different about them, we need to return to the condensation process and look at how it's different in the inner solar system. The main difference between the inner and outer solar systems is temperature. It's a lot warmer in the inner solar system, and that takes away one of the three main components of solid body accretion, hydrogen compounds. When it's warm, things like ice don't freeze, so there won't be any water ice available when solid body accretion happens in the inner solar system. The boundary between the warm inner solar system and the cooler outer solar system is the frost line, at about 2 to 3 AU. The distance from the sun where water begins to freeze as you move outward. Bruce is swimming in here because this is where most people make their mistakes on solar system formation. We often see people arguing that the rock and metal falls to the center of the solar system or that there isn't any gas in the inner solar system. This is not what we expect. Rock and metal can condense anywhere in the disk, and since it's in orbit, there's no reason for it to fall towards the inner solar system. Similarly, there was plenty of gas in the inner solar system during the early phases of planet formation. However, as we'll see next, not very much of this gas was accreted.
The solid material in the inner solar system goes through solid body accretion, just like we described earlier. However, since there isn't any solid ice in the inner solar system, there's a lot less raw material to work with, so the planets that accrete are much smaller. In fact, they're so much smaller, they accrete little or no gas from the disk. This is why terrestrial planets have almost no hydrogen and helium the way outer solar system planets do. When we discussed accretion earlier, we also pointed out that the largest impactors were the size of small planets. When the planets they hit are also this size, the results can be even more dramatic than simply changing a planet's tilt. Click on the link to see an example of this. This video shows a simulation of a collision between two bodies, one the size of the Earth and the other the size of Mars. The smaller Mars-sized body is destroyed in the impact, with most of its mass accreted by the larger body. However, some of the rocky mantle of the smaller body remains in orbit, where it can later accrete to form a moon. This moon has almost no iron, since the iron core of the impactor was accreted by the larger body. Of course, we know of at least one example of a moon that formed just this way. It's the Earth's own moon, which we've already seen is one of the exceptional objects in our solar system. It's not only the largest moon in the inner solar system, it's also got a very tiny metal core. It's mostly rocky material, like a planet's mantle. This is just the sort of unusual composition we would expect to result from a giant collision.
Let's look at the different ways we know of making moons around planets and other bodies. We've now seen two of them, but we'll add a third one to the list. The first way was part of the formation of giant planets. During gas accretion, a subdisk forms around the growing Jovian world. Within this disk, solids condense, and solid body accretion happens, building up many of the moons around the Jovian planets, including almost all of the large moons and many of the smaller ones. These moons of Saturn probably formed this way. The next way we saw to make a moon was through large collisions. The collision between a protoplanet and the Earth, which produced our moon, is an example of this. Many planetary scientists think that many of the dwarf planets and asteroids that have moons may have gotten them this way, such as Pluto's moon, Charon. There's one last way to get a moon, gravitational capture of a planetesimal. Anytime a planetesimal gets too close to a planet, there's a risk that it might be captured by that planet's gravity. This is much more likely if the planetesimal collides with something, causing it to lose orbital energy while it's close to the planet. It's not clear how many moons could have been captured this way, but there are a few that seem likely candidates, either because of their composition, like the moons of Mars, or because their orbits are at odd angles or even completely backwards compared to the direction the planet spins. Some of the small outer moons of the Jovian planets, and one large moon, Neptune's Triton, all have these sorts of backwards orbits that make them likely to be captured objects.
In our solar system, this separation into inner and outer solar systems caused by condensation leads directly to the distinction between terrestrial and Jovian planets. As we'll see later in this chapter, the extra mass of solid hydrogen compounds in the outer solar system allows planets to form more quickly and much larger, letting them go on to gas accretion and produce the Jovian planets.